What does it mean to leave a legacy in basketball? A team leaves a legacy based on titles or playoffs won, record numbers, winning streaks, or games played. But the legacy of a particular player is somewhat more complex than that. When looking at the individual accomplishments throughout the NBA history, a legacy comes down to what it is one leaves behind. It's about how they leave their mark on the game of basketball. When looking at the career of Steve Nash, for instance, we believe without a doubt it was his ability to flawlessly read the game unlike any other that became his legacy. Before we jump into the video, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon. NBA fans who have been following the sport for more than a decade cannot help but remember the Suns of the second half of the past decade when they see teams playing run and gun or a ball quintet on the court. So when a point guard plays for this team, it's impossible not to remember Steve Nash. But there is far more than just one thing to remember this particular player by. From Tony Parker's picks and rolls, to Chris Paul's order, from Kyrie Irving's instinct, to Russell Westbrook's determination, from Rajon Rondo's vision, to Damian Lillard's vertigo. All of this, to a greater or lesser extent, we have seen before in the figure of Nasty Nash. Stephen Curry himself, a fashionable player and idol of the new hordes who are found of the best league in the world, make no secret of the fact that the Canadian has always been a source of inspiration to him.
We looked at him as sort of the next Steve Nash, and I still think there are a lot of similar qualities, just the skill and the cerebral nature. They're different in that Steph is more of a natural scorer and Nash is more of a natural passer.
In 1996, the Phoenix Suns had the 15th pick in the draft. In Syracuse, he had a powerful forward of just over 2 meters, who had averaged more than 22 points and almost 9 rebounds per game in his last year of college. The Arizona team was determined, but Donnie Nelson, who had just arrived that summer at the Grand Canyon State as an assistant, knew of a white boy from a lesser-known university, Santa Clara. He had been working the previous years on the Warriors, and the closeness allowed him to attend Broncos meetings. But he put all the meat on the table to meet their request. Jerry Colangelo, head of the Suns, asked for assurances. Nelson's response was emphatic: "If Steve's not a star, you can have my job." Steve had been in that situation before, about being a choice and not a preference. Ian Hyde-Lay was Nash's coach in high school. The point guard averaged almost a triple-double during his time at St. Michael's, 21.3 points, 9.1 rebounds, and 11.2 assists. But there was a problem that severely limited his aspirations. He did it in Victoria, British Columbia. Considering the fact that he had done this on Canadian soil, and scouts don't necessarily drop in like they would in the US, it wasn't as widely recognized. Hyde-Lay sent letters recommending his ward to over 30 universities, Arizona, Duke, Villanova, Indiana, etc., who kindly declined. Other candidates, like Washington, which is very close to Victoria, did not even reply. Being a high school player, when your visibility is high, you can get over 300 cards trying to recruit you. That doesn't happen north of the border. Only Santa Clara, a university located south of San Francisco with less than 4,000 students, showed any interest in the young man. Steve barely knew them. Fortunately for him, Scott Graydon, assistant coach, got a tape of his plays. Dick Davey, coach of the Broncos, entered the video room just as his assistant was viewing its contents. At that very moment, they decided they had to go see it live. After the first game, Davey was clear: "Defensively, you're the worst player I've ever seen, but I want you on my team." It's clear that he must have been very good at all other areas. And little by little, his opponents discovered that too. He was the best player they had ever heard of. Steve landed in 1996, at the age of 22, on a team that included Kevin Johnson and Jason Kidd, two all-stars in the position of one. Young Nash barely averaged 10 minutes in his first 65 games in the first season, and just over 20 in his second. Although Johnson would retire before the beginning of his third year in the Nash League, the starting spot was assigned to Jason Kidd, who was practically awarded star status the moment he stepped foot in Dallas. With all of these things considered, it didn't take Steve Nash very long to go in a different direction when the opportunity presented itself. The Mavericks had taken on Don Nelson, Donnie's father, as head coach. The son left with him and went back to betting on Nash. He convinced his father that Steve was the man they needed. Nash's first year in Dallas was a disaster. He came out of it with the worst shooting percentages of his career, despite starting every game and playing more than 30 minutes a night. The second year did not go as expected, being relegated to the bench in 29 of his 56 games that were played. The other bases of the team were Robert Pack and Hubert Davis. That's how it was. Nelly didn't understand what was going on until the Canadian came clean. "I'm a playmaker. I want to pass the ball. It's my nature." The coach's response was blunt: That's fine, but to become a freaking dominant player, you have to shoot too. You want to be generous, but sometimes when you don't shoot, you're selfish. One thing will complement the other. From that point on, Nash started to grow. Along with Dirk Nowitzki and Michael Finley, he launched basketball in Dallas. And for the next 4 years, the Mavs were candidates for everything. They shared the best overall record in regular season with the San Antonio Spurs, who they would face in the conference finals. Tim Duncan, 28 points, 16.7 rebounds, 5.8 assists, 3 blocks, and 57% in the field averages in the series would slam the door on their aspirations. Nash was loved in Dallas, but when he became a free agent, Phoenix Suns came back for him, offering him $65 million for 6 years. The year before, they already seemed to be preparing the gap to be filled by Nash. When they decided to transfer Stephen Marbury, the starting point guard for 3 years in Arizona, in the middle of the campaign. In Italy, he had tried a system based on early shooting, but he had some reservations about doing this in the NBA. In a meeting with the Colangelos, Jerry's son Brian would tell D'Antoni to play with the top 5 players available, something he wanted to hear. Amari Stoudemire and Sean Marion became the league's most versatile inner pair, and with Joe Johnson and Quentin Richardson in the wings, Nash was free to make his own decisions. After watching Steve take advantage of the situation, getting Phoenix to surpass 110 points per game, first in the league, and lead in the league in 3-shot attempts, conversions, and success from beyond the line, the coach called this the explosion of the game. Playing run-and-gun basketball, the Suns recorded the best record of the season, and Steve Nash was recognized as the baton of an orchestra whose performances bordered on the divine, awarding him the MVP of that course. Unfortunately for him, in the postseason, he was once again faced with a Duncan in full. And despite Amari's monstrous series, some Spurs on the way to their third ring took him away from glory. After a season talked about by many, Richardson and Johnson prioritized dollars over a project. To cover the losses, Rajah Bell, Kurt Thomas, and Boris Diav arrived in Phoenix that summer. But within 3 games, it was clear that it would not work. The bookmakers withdrew their confidence in the Suns. Normally, he would have gone with the flow, but Nash had other plans. He raised his game even higher while Leandro Barbosa stepped forward. Only the Pistons, Spurs, and Mavericks won more games than the Arizona franchise. The direct leader was once again the compass in the park. The conference final would be a highlight in 2006, falling to his former team. Amari's loss was crucial. With Stoudemire, life is easier. After his return and the confirmation of Barbosa, 6th best man of the season, the Suns' win was 61. Nash would mark possibly his best year ever, but his friend Dirk Nowitzki would go on to have an epic season after falling in the finals last year, leading his team to an unbeatable record for the rest. However, it wasn't the Dallas boys who would cut the Suns off again. Once again, it was San Antonio, and specifically Tim Duncan. In one of the most controversial series of the last decade, the Alamo would kill any hope that Phoenix had left. Grant Hill explains the Nash era this way. Under Steve's direction, everything seemed to be in chaos. But there was an order in that model. A lot of teams today have taken that cycle, and I think Nash is part of that, developing the importance of the base. Today, you see Westbrook, Lillard, Curry, Paul. If you have them on your team, you give them the keys and you trust their instincts. Finally, at the age of 38, he signed with the Lakers, who had also acquired Dwight Howard, who at the time was the most dominant center in the league. Along with Kobe Bryant and Pau Gasol, the formula seemed to be winning. But it seemed that the combination of both Nash and Gasol's physical problems, along with the poor relationship between the two other pillars of the project, blew their chances of doing something big. And in the 2013-14 season, his body finally decided it had had enough. Moyer, dazzled by the game of the Warriors, do not know that before them were those Suns. The legacy of Steve Nash, a boy born in South Africa and educated in Canada, transcends borders. When we look back, we see D'Antoni as the architect of the work, but he alone had the plans for the building. Everything else, what you saw of the structure, was Nash's doing. D'Antoni put the pieces on the board. Nash decided how they were going to move. On March 21st, 2015, Steve Nash made his withdrawal official by letter in the Players' Tribune. I once heard someone say, "There comes a day when we're told we can't play anymore. We're not good enough. We don't qualify. Too slow, maybe." When you're a teenager with boundless dreams and a growing obsession, and someone tells you it's not going to last forever, it's terrifying. When I think about my career, I can't stop thinking about the kid with his ball, falling in love. That's what I still identify with, and did throughout my entire history. Make sure to subscribe and leave us a like down below. Check out some of these videos that appear on your